I am older than the pediatric surgery department in terms of work experience in St. John's. I'm obviously much, much older than the pediatric surgery department here. But I still remember when Ashley started the department. And I still remember the days when I used to attend the operations. I used to watch the operations. And I used to really enjoy doing that. And I can't understand why our residents don't do that now. Or why our faculty don't do that now. But we learn so much from watching you people operate. We appreciate the problems that you go through while operating with small veins. And I've always said, I have seen surgeries during internship, especially orthopedics. And my leave the lights on, so otherwise everybody will, even early morning they'll go out to sleep.
It's not bad, they have a dedicated group of people.
So compared to, my impression of surgery used to be orthopedic surgery with all the blood and all that. And then when I saw pediatric surgeons operate, I said, this is what is bloodless surgery. I mean, you people handle those babies so beautifully. I wasn't trying to butter you. But I really felt that that's something I need to tell, because pediatric surgeons, though you all keep saying we're a poorer kind of fraternity of the surgeons, I think you people work with your heart and you're fantastic too. And it's very nice to see a lot of the, what I call the pediatric surgical alumni of St. John's. And congratulations, Kanishka, on the 25 years and on the conference. I really don't know what and how much I can speak on neonatal ventilation for the next 20-25 minutes. And I just thought I'll address a few issues. The first is, where should the surgical neonate be taken care of? And there was a very nice article in Journal of Neonatal Surgery, a kind of debate. I think Dr. Siddharth Ramji, who is at MAMSI, and Dr. Neelam Clare, who is at Gangaram, Siddharth Ramji had said they should be in a surgical, neonatal surgical unit, whereas Neelam Clare and her group said no, they should be in the neonatal intensive care. Obviously, there are pros and cons, but personally, I think most of the neonatal babies who are undergoing surgery should be managed in the neonatal surgical unit, and particularly a TEF baby. I am scared of those tracheoesophageal fistula babies. And the moment Kanishka sends them occasionally to neonatal unit, I'll tell the residents, I said, make sure this fellow doesn't extubate, because if he or she extubates, you'll have it. So I'm very scared of some of those babies. But yes, there are certain groups where we need more than just what a pediatric surgeon can do. So I thought I should introduce this concept. I'm sure most of you know about the level 1, level 2, level 3 neonatal unit care. But we have further gone to classify level 3. Some people, of course, make 3C as 4. But we have 3A, where we look at greater than 1,000 grams, greater than 28 weeks. And I think surgical residents, surgical pediatric surgical consultants may be comfortable about more than 1,500 grams, more than 30 weeks, definitely. 1,000 grams, 28 weeks, you will be a little uncomfortable. 3B is where we have high frequency ventilation and inhaled nitric oxide, and we have a full range of medical and surgical support. And 3C, of course, where we have ECMO and we have facilities for cardiac surgery, because I think that's a whole different kind of management that we need to do. So what I plan to do in the next 20-25 minutes is when to ventilate, just a brief kind of an overview, how to ventilate, normal lung supportive ventilation versus abnormal lung ventilation. Because we are the ones who deal with the abnormal lung, and when you're ventilating, it's mostly supportive ventilation perioperative. Special situations of very low birth weight and preterm neonates. Of course, the nightmare that is diaphragmatic hernia. I think, Kanishka, that baby is doing like okay, fairly okay now. Diaphragmatic hernia, I get sleepless nights. I don't know what you people do, but I get sleepless nights whenever there's a diaphragmatic hernia. Then a little bit of newer modes of ventilation, precautions and complications. You know when you're going to ventilate your babies, but most common would be perioperative period. If you have a baby with pneumonia, with any of the surgical problems, You have a preterm baby who's got RDS with surgical problems. You have babies with congenital malformations of thorax or abdomen. You have supportive ventilation for a sick neonate. So these are the reasons you would ventilate. But I think you may end up with problems ventilating an ELBW baby, a less than 1,000 gram baby, a less than 28 weeks baby, because the concept is totally changed over there, and they misbehave. And of course, congenital diaphragmatic hernia, I would feel that you need somebody with a level 3B kind of a unit to take care of a baby with congenital diaphragmatic hernia. So indications for ventilation would be, if you look at clinical indications, would be obviously if the baby has got respiratory distress, if the baby is apneic, if the baby has got poor respiratory effort, or if the baby is in respiratory failure, it makes sense. But you would also like to ventilate babies if they're very sick, and supportive ventilation during the perioperative period. You're given them anesthesia, they're not really breathing very well, and you want to support them. And of course, you all know the biochemical indications that if your oxygenation is low and carbon dioxide is high. So these are simple facts. And you all know how a ventilator works, or if you don't know, you should know how a ventilator works. Because I think if we understand the machine, we'll be able to use, not that you can't ventilate a baby without understanding the machine, but you will be able to use it to its full potential if you understand the machine, just like the fancy phones everybody has. I mean, there's no point in me having a fancy phone because I can't understand but you must, and I'm 100% certain that 80% of the people who have those fancy phones don't utilize it to their full extent. So please understand the kind of ventilator you're using so that we can use it to its optimum potential. Now, what can we control using the ventilation? We can definitely look at the oxygenation, we can look at the peak inspiratory pressure, we can look at the peak end expiratory pressure, we can look at the ventilator rate, we can look at the inspiration time, IE ratio, we can adjust the flow, and in some of our newer ventilators, we can look at tidal volume. Because conventionally, we have always been using the pressure-limited ventilation where we could only control this. But now we have modalities where we can look at tidal volume. Normally, I'm talking about an abnormal lung for some time in terms of just a concept. I don't think 20-25 minutes I can really talk on too much on neonatal ventilation. And I would suggest Kanishka and the rest of you, I think all your MCH pediatric surgeons should undergo the 4-day or a 5-day ventilation workshop which we organize for the neonatal residents. And I think that will be very useful for them and they'll give them confidence. So I just wanted to highlight something here. Like if you're looking at RDS, a lot of us have been pre-surfactant era where we used to use pressures of 20, 24, etc. to inflate them. But for post-surfactant era, we hardly have to use, you know, something like 18, 20. You don't need to use very high pressures. But PEEP is very important over there. Compare it with the supportive ventilation that you will be providing for your babies perioperatively. Very minimum PIPs, just a basic PEEP of 4, rates of 30 to 40, oxygenation. So just remember that what you're ventilating is usually, hopefully, a normal lung, and therefore you don't need to be very aggressive in your parameters. Okay. The second concept which I just thought I will tell is, of course, very simple, but just a kind of recap, keep these simple basic rules. If you want the CO2 to increase, you have to if you find that the CO2 is high and you want to, I think this slide is very stupid slide actually, I made it and it's a very stupid slide, but if your CO2 is high, basically all you need to do is increase the rate and increase the PEEPs. Ignore this. If you find that your CO2 is low, then you need to decrease the rate and you need to decrease the PEEP. Similarly for oxygen, if you find that the oxygen is high, you need to decrease the FiO2, you need to decrease the PIT, you need to decrease all the parameters. Whereas if your oxygen is low, you could increase all these parameters. So very simple basic concept, please ignore this part. So now that we have said what are the reasons why we want to ventilate, what are the basic settings we can adjust with the conventional ventilation? What do we do with if there is a CO2 increase or decrease? What do we do if the O2 increase or decrease? Let's figure out what would be, when do I say, okay, this baby is adequately ventilated? This is something important for the residents. If you have a baby who is ventilated and is having any problems of retraction, I think then you are not ventilating that baby properly. Either there's something which is secretions, or the tube is blocked, or there is a lung pathology which is creating problems. So adequacy of ventilation is there should not be any retractions, adequate chest expansion, adequate air entry, good saturations, and a well-perfused baby. In preterm babies, we are very happy with 89% to 92%. I don't want any of you to see a 95% saturation in a preterm baby. Just remember, anything less than 95% is all right, but you shouldn't be creating hyperoxia for these preterm babies, and you know the kind of blood gas that you want. So the next concept I want to introduce is, earlier we used to talk about, okay, RDS, this is what you do, this is what you do, this is what you do. Now for all the pathology, we talk about what are your target blood gases. And your target blood gases differ depending on the kind of disease process that you're looking at. Obviously your target blood gas for a surgical baby will be very simple. You want your PO2s around 50 to 70, CO2 around 40, 45, pH is this. But look at this here, there is a change in an RDS baby. Because we're dealing with preterms, we don't want very high oxygens. And we do allow CO2s to go up a little bit because we talk about permissive hypercapnia. We don't want to overventilate these babies and create chronic lung disease for these babies. In a baby with chronic lung disease, we want a little higher oxygens, but look at your CO2s, which is much higher. Your diaphragmatic hernia babies, we want this very well. CO2 is 40-50, and I think we need pH is very normal in these babies because otherwise PPH worsens in these babies. So the concept of target blood gases. Your aim of ventilating the baby is to achieve the target blood gases, and therefore you need to periodically do the blood gases and figure out, am I doing right or wrong for these babies? So we ventilated the babies, we said, what do we want to achieve? We want to achieve target blood gases for that gestation of baby and for that disease process. And when you decide to wean, obviously it depends on the why we ventilate. If it is only for a perioperative ventilation, once the baby starts developing spontaneous respiration, you can actually wean off the baby. It depends on natural history of disease. See, natural history of disease, RDS, earlier you have all learned in your MBBS days, 72 hours. Now the whole thing is changed because the moment you give surfactant, RDS pathology changes. So we actually hardly ventilate RDS babies, we just give them surfactant, put them on CPAP for about 24 hours and then they're out of ventilator. Whereas if you have a baby with meconium aspiration syndrome, obviously you need to ventilate them for a little longer period. If you have a baby with apnea, you need to ventilate for a longer period. If you have a baby with pneumonia, you need to ventilate them for a longer period. Okay? Again, weaning depends on the disease process. If it's a normal lung, get the baby off the ventilator as soon as possible. But if you're dealing with a pneumonia, if you're dealing with a preterm baby who also has RDS, if you're dealing with a preterm baby who also has PDA, then you will have to keep doing your blood gases, look at your target blood gases, and then wean the baby more slowly. And wean the most traumatic parameters first, which is PIP and FiO2, particularly in preterm babies. Term babies, in fact, the smaller babies, you see, I have started referring, most of us have started referring to the 3 kg babies as adult babies. And if you start looking at those 800 grams and 700 grams and 900 grams, those 3 kg fellows really look. So we're not really worried about that group of babies. But we're certainly worried about the smaller babies where we make sure that we have gentle ventilation. When can I extubate a baby? I can extubate a baby. Obviously, the baby should be having spontaneous respiration. The pathology should be better. But I can't extubate a baby when I'm using pressures of 20, 24 and rates of 60 or something like that. I need to bring it down to minimal oxygens, minimal pips, minimal peep and a rate of 20 to 30, and then only I can wean the baby off, either to wood box oxygen, or my advice for a smaller baby, for a preterm baby, for a baby who's less than 32 weeks, for a baby who's around less than 1500 grams, I think you should go on to CPAP and then take the baby off the ventilator. Bigger baby, you can just wean it off straight away to wood box oxygen, but for a preterm baby, it would be good to wean them off to CPAP. So we already said that there should be good spontaneous effort of sedation. I don't know whether you follow this or whether you need to follow, but at least when we are weaning the babies off, we ensure that we are weaning their fentanyl. We use a lot of fentanyl. Then if it's a preterm baby, we would like the baby to be either on caffeine or aminophylline so that the baby doesn't get into epic episodes. We don't keep them on feeds. They should be stable. They should have a normal PCV and they should be on parental nutrition or good nutrition before we wean them off the... Because all these things, if the baby has a low PCV, if the baby is unstable, baby can, or if the baby is sedated, you'll find that the baby needs to be re-ventilated. So therefore, we want to make sure that the baby doesn't get re-ventilated. Again, post-extubation makes sense. I have already said about consider CPAP. You'll monitor the baby. Earlier, we used to be very aggressive with chest physiotherapy for these babies. We used to really beat up those babies. But there is data to say that there is an increased incidence of intraventricular hemorrhage, and therefore we are really, really careful about physiotherapy, chest physiotherapy. So only if there is a collapse, only if there are a lot of secretions, we do chest physiotherapy. Otherwise, routinely, we do not use chest physiotherapy. Blood gases we have talked about, and even suctioning. Earlier it used to be very frequent suctioning. Now we say please keep, you know, don't trouble the baby too much. If you find there are secretions, please suction. Otherwise there is no emergency for you to keep suctioning the baby every 2 hours or something. Now so far we've been talking about good babies. Babies who just require perioperative ventilation, uncomplicated problems. But this is a group of babies. I mean, if you ask me, even I wouldn't want to touch them and I wouldn't want you to take care of them. This could be severe RDS, this could be pulmonary hemorrhage, this could be a PDA with pulmonary edema, anything. But these babies are going to be difficult to ventilate, and obviously your diaphragmatic cardias are going to be difficult to ventilate. The whole concept of RDS has changed, I have already told you. VLBW, ELBW, difficult to ventilate. RDS concept is totally changed, surfactant, CPAP, and the baby is out of ventilator. Aseptic precautions, especially, I mean, I think it should be there for all babies. Now, by aseptic precautions, earlier, about 10 years ago, I used to just say hand wash, hand wash, hand wash. But I think it's beyond hand wash. It's how your aid girl and how your helper cleans the unit. You know, so it's so many things. It's, do we share the same medication? Do we share the same nurse for two babies? So there are a lot of things beyond hand wash for infection control. And then we have these, in this group of babies, ventilator lung injury is definitely higher in these babies, and chronic lung disease is a complication. And I have already talked about TEF. I'm scared of these babies. Avoid. I sometimes tell the resident, just sit there with the baby with your hand and the endotracheal tube, because I don't want it to. And if for any reason the fellow gets extubated, please call the surgeon. Correct, Kanishka? Am I right? Yes. I keep telling that to all our residents also, so don't worry. Diaphragmatic hernia is a whole different, I mean, I know there is a sea change in the management of congenital diaphragmatic hernia. From aggressive, immediate surgery to wait, let's take care of the baby and then go on to surgery. Problems obviously are pulmonary hypoplasia, PPHN. So this concept everybody understands, stabilize before surgery. And pulmonary vasodilators, we may have to use, NO to decrease the PPHN. So this is a group of babies I would prefer is in a unit where the nurses and residents are capable of managing a baby with PPHN. So So I've talked about which babies you can admit or you can ventilate in a pediatric surgical unit, which baby you may need help. It could be you ventilate in an NICU or you could get a consult from a neonatal or a pediatric person. That's a different issue. Now we move on to some newer concepts of ventilation. This is your conventional ventilation where you have the ventilator going on its own and the baby going on also. Obviously, there are going to be problems, and therefore, problems are going to be air leaks, IVH, increased work of breathing. Therefore, you have different modes of ventilation, and the simplest is synchronized ventilation. So you have your spontaneous breathing, and that triggers a ventilator breath. Obviously, this is much more physiological. So whatever changes have occurred in newborn ventilation is to make it more physiological, nothing else. More gentle, more physiological, less damage to the lungs. Those are all the concepts. Earlier, volume-targeted ventilation was a no-no as far as neonates is concerned. We said pressure is important, we will give pressure. But then we found that babies get into problems. Very simple example, that if you have a baby with RDS and you're using your pressure-limited ventilation, we find that as the compliance improves, to administer that pressure, a lot of volume is given to this baby, and the baby gets what is called as volume trauma, which is even more problematic than barotrauma. Whereas if you're using volume ventilation, even with a change in compliance, the same volume is administered and therefore volume trauma is reduced. And this was the basis for why people started using volume ventilator in neonates. Okay? So conventional is pressure limited. That means ventilator provides each breath without exceeding the set pressure and you get volume trauma. Whereas in volume-controlled ventilation, you set a specific tidal volume that is to be delivered, and therefore the baby doesn't have volume trauma. So volume-controlled versus pressure-limited. Here you get a constant tidal volume, decreased volume trauma. Yes, you could increase barotrauma. Therefore, you have what we call hybrid ventilators, which I'll talk about. And in pressure-limited, it limits barotrauma. There is a risk of high tidal volume and therefore increased risk of volume. Then you have something called a pressure support ventilation where ventilator detects the spontaneous breath and delivers some amount of flow so that the pressure, so as the baby is picking up spontaneous respiration, which I think is important for you in a surgical, because the baby is coming out of anesthesia, it's going to not suddenly start breathing normally. So if you could use a pressure support ventilation while you are getting the baby off the ventilator, I think this would be a useful concept for you to use while weaning the baby. So this is usually is a weaning strategy. I said if you use a pure volume ventilator, you can get barotrauma. And if you use a pure pressure ventilation, you get volume trauma. And therefore, we have hybrid forms where you can allow, you can adjust the pressure and the tidal volume. And you can have your conventional flow, conventional pressure ventilation, but you will make sure that a certain volume is assured. So don't get sort of hassled by these terms. Just understand that these newer methods are there, which are strategies to decrease trauma to these babies. And a lot of the current ventilators have these options, so learn about them and utilize them. That's all the message that I can give here. Then we talk about the fancy high-frequency ventilation. I think everybody was extremely excited about this high-frequency ventilation when it came. Very simple concept, smaller tidal volumes, rapid rates. Because these are the days when we used to see a lot of barotrauma, bronchopulmonary dysplasia, which we now call as CLD. And he said, if we make sure that the tidal volume is less for these babies, maybe you will be able to decrease the incidence of chronic lung disease. Okay? So it is certainly useful in these situations, chronic lung disease, meconium aspiration, PPHN, pulmonary leaks, pulmonary hemorrhage, and congenital diaphragmatic hernia. But there is no study which has shown that a primary ventilation in HFP in any of these conditions are useful. So we actually use conventional ventilation and move on to high frequency ventilation if we are using a very high pressure or if we need to use a very high tidal valve. And it definitely reduces the ventilator induced lung injury. Just a word about CPAP, non-invasive ventilation. At least as far as our RDS is concerned, we have moved away from invasive ventilation to non-invasive ventilation. And I think you could use this post-surgery when you're weaning the baby off in preterm babies. Otherwise, I don't see any situation where you could use this as a primary modality of ventilation. But please remember, in preterms, we use a lot of CPAP as a supportive ventilation. I think that could happen. You've had a baby whom you've extubated and you find that the baby is having a little increased work of breathing. He's requiring 30% oxygen. If you put him on CPAP, you'll find that you can actually reduce the oxygen to about 25%. You're just supporting, you're just keeping his lungs open so that he doesn't have to do a lot of work to get his lungs ventilated. So I think this is some, if you find a preterm baby having a little distress, this is a good modality of ventilating baby. CPAP, when we use CPAP, we just use 4 to 6 centimeters peak and expiratory pressure, and we use as minimal oxygen as possible for these babies. Ventilator-induced lung injury, so you've heard of these things, barotrauma, rheo, water trauma, and biotrauma, basically, because there's a lot of cytokine-induced injury because of ventilation, which is what causes chronic lung disease, and we need to be aware of these things. The next concept I wanted to introduce was, we've talked about newer modes of ventilation, we've talked about high-frequency ventilation, we've talked about non-invasive ventilation. A lot of your ventilators have pulmigraphs. The question would be, is it really useful? I think it is useful to fine-tune our ventilator. You really don't need it for a simple three-day ventilation, I don't think you need it. But if you're dealing with sicker babies, you're dealing with smaller babies, I think this will help. Just to give an example, this is your flow volume loop, and this will tell you that there are secretions. Okay, so if you have it, your nurses also will be able to pick it up and say, all right, fine, let me suction this baby because there are a lot of secretions. Okay, so this is a pressure volume loop, this is a flow volume loop, and I think it is good for, I again tell you that MCH students should be going through these ventilation workshops to know a lot more about these things. So we come to the last one or two slides. Complications, sepsis. Therefore, we are saying, let's go the non-invasive way. Air leaks. Therefore, we are saying gentler ventilation. Chronic lung disease, because of all those trauma that we talked about, therefore we say let's go on to gentle ventilation. And of course, you have an acutely desaturating baby, which I think is a problem which you face day in and day out. And for that, how many of you know what is DOPE? How many of you know what is DOPE? Raise your hands if you know. Okay, all right. DOPE is the usual thing that we use as a guideline for our residents when there is a baby who is desaturated. It is basically displacement of tube. O is for obstruction of tube. P is for pneumothorax. E is for equipment failure. So simple things. We always say, please run through this whenever you have a baby. So if a baby is desaturating, what do? You first check if the tube is all right, if the tube is blocked, if there are any secretions, if the tube is displaced, and then you re-intubate the baby. If it's still desaturating, you look at air leak. If it's still desaturating, you check if the equipment is a problem. If it's still desaturating, we look at, is there any pathology in the lung which has made it worse, hemorrhage or whatever. Okay, so that's something you need to understand. Precautions, gentle ventilation, non-invasive ventilation, avoid giving any bugs to these babies. Avoid giving any bugs to these babies. good nursing care, appropriate monitoring, developmentally supported care, family counseling and support. A lot of times this support is financial support. Also saturation, obviously, this baby is likely to go on to PPHN and we need to look at pulmonary vasodilators. We need to maybe switch on to high frequency medication. So these are the problems that we can have. What would you do if a VLBW neonate with RDS also has an abdominal pathology with requiring surgery? I think you need to give surfactant to these babies. So either you train yourself to give surfactant, which I think is perfectly all right, or you call somebody who will give surfactant, because that becomes a primary issue over here. Surfactant, ventilate, and then you operate. There is no problem. Nobody's stopping you from operating. But in this group of babies, I think surfactant would become an important problem. So just to sum up, ideal place for a surgical neonate is to get ventilated in a surgical emergency. I think you people know the pathology, the surgical pathology much better than us. Most surgical neonates can be ventilated in surgery, but there are special situations where you need help of a person trained or a person, I wouldn't say trained, a person doing more frequently ventilation with this group of babies, that is your ELBW babies and your congenital diaphragmatic hernia. Conventional modes of ventilation are good for normal lung ventilation. Current concept is non-invasive and gentle ventilation. Surgeons running an ICU should understand these concepts. Surfactant and nitric oxide are a must in any unit operating small neonates and those operating on congenital diaphragmatic hernia. And neonatal ventilation requires more than machine to provide safe ventilation. With those messages, just a word of caution to all of us. I'm sure you're all aware of this, that there is some evidence that anesthetics can cause long-term problems in animal studies and in human studies. A word of caution to all of us, and I've been talking about this particular child for the last 4 weeks ever since I saw her. I have a child who is 23 years, who is admitted in the psychiatry ward. The father came and met me. He said, "Hello, madam, how are you? You remember my baby?" I said, and I'm always scared when they say, "You remember my baby," because I don't know what I have done to that baby. Said, "Yeah, I remember." Said, "No, she's admitted in the psychiatry ward. She's got a bipolar disorder." I got pretty agitated because I mean, I'm okay with CP. I'm used to CP. All right. So then I went to the psychiatrist, I went to Maheshwari, and I said, "Look, I said, is there any data to say that there is an increased incidence of, I know behavioral disorders, ADHD and all, I know it much more." She said, "Yes, there is definitely increased incidence of even psychiatric disorders, bipolar disorders in babies who have had perinatal injury." So I just wanted to remind ourselves that we are extremely a responsible group of physicians and surgeons who are dealing with babies whose brains have to still develop. And I think we need to be as careful and do as much little harm as possible to these babies. And, you know, if you can avoid a general anesthesia, fantastic. If you can do it under local anesthesia, fantastic. If you can do a quicker surgery, fantastic. So let's just keep this in mind and continue to take care of babies. Thank you very much.